Pick up on this.
Attack of the WTF.
F,
exactly.
WTF, Kevin.
I don't know, Sarah. This show is going to be a fond look back at our not-so-proudest moments, is a way to put it.
Yeah, that's right. Sometimes our heart's in the right place, but things don't really work out the way we wanted them to.
Surprising enough, happens more often than we'd like to admit.
As a television show, you're always trying to get new stuff.
Get it before it gets out.
Get it before it gets out. So a lot of times we scour the internet, we find something that seems really great, and somehow the execution just isn't as revolutionary as it seemed in our heads.
I blame it on the producers, though, not on the talent. And
Because we are merely talking heads, not our fault.
That's it. We're meat puppets. We dance when people pull our strings. But to start us off, here is supervising producer Gavin Purcell, who thought it was a brilliant idea to introduce the world to the TV sheriff.
Ooh.
Right, Gav?
Yes. Revolutionary. TV sheriff, I thought, was revolutionary.
Sure.
I know that some people enjoyed it and some people didn't, but I guess we'll be taking a look at it.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's see it.
TV sheriff.
Show us how they do whatever it is that they do. Just stick around.
You know, actually, that wasn't that bad.
Be kind and rewind. It's the video wave. That's all I can say after that.
All right, but that was all well and good. The performance was fine and dandy.
I actually really liked it. I liked it a lot the second time.
But then, and Gavin's already shaking his head, because we interviewed them not realizing that they were going to stay in character the entire time.
It's like
and
video that's when, real.
That's when all hell broke loose. Take a look at this. All right, this band of crazy characters has appeared all around the world with their special brand of video mixing mayhem, and now we're going to learn exactly how they do it. TV Sheriff, we just saw a little bit of your intro that you do.
That's just the intro. You wouldn't let us play our show properly because there's laws in the land, unfortunately.
And those the type of content that you normally show, the laws are protecting that. What kind of content is that?
Well, it's copyright law type things, and, you know, just like this mustache, it has a copyright, for example.
Right.
It has to be copyrighted. No one's allowed to... Sorry about that.
Fair enough.
No one's allowed to touch it, my mustache, except for me. But anyway, that's a whole another story. Excuse me. Sorry. It's actually my eyebrow. But normally, it is a copyright law issue, but we're not about law. We're about justice.
Justice.
Justice for the enslaved television humanity. It's time to...
How do you bring your justice to the people? What are the tools that you're using to do this?
Well, we use video instruments. This one is a corn pewter doohickey.
You got a laptop,
thing, which
all right,
I got a bunch
done.
Of wires and stuff.
Wires
and it's using a software program system that they call VJAM Pro that was designed by the Cold Cut VJ outfit, DJ VJ outfit.
Very nice. Now, and that's the software that tells it, okay, when I hit this key, play this video, and...
That's right, it does that.
Prospector, what are you using exactly? Are you...
I got a special Eddie Roll V4, and it allows me to mix audio and video.
Very nice. And, you do it well, Prospector.
Thank you very much.
We've given you some content from our show, and you've prepared a little demo for us. Is that
That's doodly doodly right.
Okay. If we could get to that, this is the TV sheriff and
his
trail
buddies. I'll give you a little show how it works. You just got to push down this button right here. If you push down the button, it's going to play some sort of video.
Very nice.
So I got a bunch of clips from the show, and we're going to do a little live remix using a little video magic monkey business.
All right, well, then let's hear it.
So come on, we need a little monkey business, and then we're going to kick it out. Kick me some monkey, baby. Kick up that monkey. Here we go. You never know what's going to happen when you push the button.
Never know. So it's all incredibly live and...
Very live.
And unrehearsed.
Very unrehearsed.
Very nice.
Improvisation.
It's brilliant stuff, guys. And maybe Video Ape can help us out with where we can find more.
Have a hard time understanding him ourselves. Our manager Eric Fensler does translate for him.
Oh, great!
So whatever he said,
Eric.
Yes. HTTP or http://www.tvsheriff.com.
Ah. All right, thanks to the translation, and thank you so much for the performance, guys.
Thank you, my man. Television, for being such a fabulous thing.
All right, I'm concerned now. Yeah, that is the one segment that has become, it's a catchphrase around the office. We're like, is this going to be another Video Ape? It's so good.
It's really got, a mythology of its own now, which is phenomenal, I think. It's, taking on a whole different world, and the Pink Ape, I think, really, you see it again, it brings out a whole new world to everybody.
Shut up, Gavin.
Yeah, seriously, what are you doing? Take it easy, hippie.
It's a whole new world. It's a real revolution, isn't it?
Do you still stand by those guys?
I found those guys a couple years ago, and I really thought they were something interesting. And as we've talked about, they actually have gone on to do multiple other things. They played at the Sony E3 party, and they're touring with Beck, who we love on the show. So obviously somebody out there thinks they're doing something interesting. I'm just not sure if it was the right fit for our show at the time. And I think that had we figured stuff out ahead of time and what they were going to do, it might have made a little bit more sense.
All right, we'll let them slide with that because, the monkey was cute.
That was good.
Gavin, thank you for coming on and defending.
Thanks, Gavin. They can't all be gems.
Oh.
Get it? Gems?
Yeah, I got it.
That's what I
get it.
Okay. When Attack of the WTF continues, we'll drag out more producers to explain things like a funky little musical guest called Kerouac.
Oh,
next.
Yeah, it is. Attack of the WTF. Attack.
Attack of the WTF. Attack. Now, we had a pair of San Francisco DJs on the show called Kerouac.
Yes.
Producer Heather Frank tried to make turntables more, let's say, visual.
Sure.
Heather?
All right, for the record, you guys, it was the roller skaters that screwed up that segment. It wasn't the guys in the back.
So the DJs weren't the problem.
No.
They weren't that dynamic, and that's why we added this visual element. But the roller skaters were amateurs.
All right, all right. Let's let the viewers be the judge before you sway them. Here's Kerouac.
Roll the tape. Now, straight off the PCH and into our studios, please welcome San Francisco's own Kerouac to Attack of the Show. Yeah!
That hiding your face is not going to help, Heather. I'm sorry.
I surrender to the horribleness of the roller skaters.
You said that they were going to bring down professional
skaters.
Supposedly,
they were supposed to be professional, and they had worked with professionals before. But I didn't know they put an ad on Craigslist at the last minute, and they got these girls from L.A., and they hadn't met them before. They didn't do a screening process or anything.
Right.
So what was that?
They were having a good time, at least.
Oh, clearly. Our audience wasn't, but they were.
Those guys are good, you know? Like, and if you go to a club, you're in a club atmosphere, and you're listening to them, they're good, but they're not meant for TV.
Sure.
I admit it.
Fair enough.
We established that.
Hey.
They were good music, though. I dug it.
Okay.
Thank you, Heather, for coming out.
You can do a good interpretation.
All right. So roller disco didn't work the first time around either, so don't feel too bad, Heather. Stick around, though. I mean, this show it's like your forum posts come to life, so enjoy it, right? We revisit our attempt to make Star Trek poetry palatable, and it's painful. It's coming up next.
Ow.
Yeah. Stung a bit. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Attack of the WTF. It's our little stroll down segments that went off the rails a bit.
Kind of like you.
Choo-choo! Now, Star Trek on its own is kind of a dicey proposition, right?
Oh, you never know what you're going to get with Star Trek.
Star Trek and poetry? Yeah, producer Brian Keller, would you care to explain that?
Mike DeMary came on to talk about Enterprise.
Right.
And because he's the first AD, and Star
Fantastic.
Trek is...
Brian, Star Trek poetry.
The poetry. Where's
Explain
the poetry
it.
Come in exactly?
Somewhere along the way, he mentioned that he had some poetry to show off, and I said, hey, why not?
Let's
give it a shot.
We're about to show everybody why not. Here it is. Mike DeMary had every geek's dream job, assistant director on Star Trek Voyager and Star Trek Enterprise, but his real talent apparently was poetry, and he's here to share with us the most beautifully written take on Star Trek since some of your internet fan fiction. Mike, welcome to the show. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
So tell us, why poetry? Is this something that you'd done throughout your entire life and now just decided to apply, you know, to Star Trek? I mean...
Not really. I've written my entire life. I used to write comic books for DC Comics. But Jerry Ryan is the reason, really, if you want to know. I would take call sheets and write little joke poems and stuff that I thought was funny to get the actors to laugh or the crew to laugh, then I'd throw them away. And she told me, stop throwing those away. You know, someday there are going to be people out there who want them. Publish them. And it took me 8 years, but I built up the courage to let some of them loose.
Very nice. Very nice. See, I do obscene doodles in my notebook liner during meeting notes.
Don't throw them away. Remember John Lennon.
See, Human Resources said if I don't throw them away, I'm gone.
Don't listen.
They beat me up.
Don't listen to them.
All right. Now, so tell me, what are the poems about now? What's the subject matter?
Well, the subject matter is life, really. It's life in Hollywood, what it's like to be working in the business. About a third of what I do specifically relates to Star Trek only because that's what I was doing. But I simply wrote what came to mind. They shift rapidly from one kind of focus to another.
Right.
From the purely humorous to the absolutely dead serious.
And purely haiku form, or?
No haiku.
No haikus, thank
no
you.
No haiku. I
thank
leave you. Those to the Asian side of the world.
Very nice. Now the poems, are they basically comedic, or are there
primarily
all serious poems?
They are comedic, because I like meter. And to have meter, you usually have to have humor.
Right.
But there are some that are about, you know, the pitfalls in life, particularly in life in Hollywood, where you spend 16 hours a day, and that's a normal day.
Right.
9 to 5 is lunch in our business.
Now, how long were you working on the actual Star Trek series?
I started on the pilot for Voyager, thinking if I do my job right, I might get a year out of this. I stayed 11 years.
Wow.
Started as a second AD and worked my way up to first AD.
Well, congrats on that, man. Now,
it's a long run.
I mean, Enterprise, though, when that got canceled, I mean, how did you take that?
It's premature.
Yeah.
There's a lot of reasonable argument for canceling a show that had the ratings that we did, but the bottom truth was it was still a profitable venture in the long run. But we live in a corporate environment now, and everybody doesn't think about 3 years from now. They think about next quarter. And if this show isn't making money next quarter, somebody feels their job's on the line, therefore they will cut the show.
Sure.
But I guarantee you, in the long run, it will make considerable money, and they'll regret that they don't have 3 more years to put out on DVDs.
Right, I bet. Yeah. So now you've taken your poems, you've put them into book form.
In the process, I got a call from you guys before I'm even ready yet. We just launched
We get it before
website.
It gets out, Mike. I don't know if you're aware. That's what
way
the show
before,
does. That's
way
our job.
Before. But we're still getting bids from printers.
Very nice. So, but when do you expect or hope to have it actually released?
The target was late October, early November, with a primarily convention release. I'm hoping to, in fact, I'm in the process now of trying to connect with conventions that want me to speak. I have multimedia events that I do at conventions, and then use that as a vehicle to sell the books. and of course have an online presence until we can convince bookstores that, you know what, there is still a poetry section. It's only this big.
Right. It's there.
You could put one book in
there.
People
browse it. It's fine. It'll fit. In fact, you know what, let's just get right to it. If you don't mind, I'd love to you know, let's hear some poetry.
This is an excerpt from Changing Captains. You want to see how it ends, go to the website. The first one they hired caused the crew all to fret. Renowned was the phrase that had chilled down the set. Instead of commanding voice writ on the page, she whispered the keyword so faintly, engage. None dared to allow themselves thought of his meaner. Only the director should question demeanor. Perplexed, without venom, he explained it as such. She disagreed soundly. His way was too butch. Her position, though clear, revealed the bad omen. She would not play a man, for she was a woman. At lunch it was busy. The veterans did hobnob. If it stays like this, we'll all need a new job. 3 days into shooting, and we started late. Another delay would be tempting bad fate. The first one knew, too, a credit to her heart. It just wasn't working. She surrendered the part. Our schedule's meaningless. Shredders in place. ADs are born ready. Chaos they embrace.
If you'd like more info on Mike Demerit, check our show notes and keep an eye out for the book later this year. Now, if I need to say any more than the feed is coming up after this break to get you to come back, then I don't know. I just don't know you anymore. Plus, a bunch of freaks were hanging out in our parking lot last week, so we decided, ah, what the hell? Maybe one of them can host this show.
Beam me the hell out of that segment.
It's okay, Brian.
Hey, at least he brought his own technology. He's beaming in and out of places. Come on.
Yeah, we'll give him that. Now, Mike, great guy. Good poetry. Good book.
Good beret.
Great beret. And
yeah.
Good delivery. Keller, what happened with the production of that segment?
I thought the production was fine.
Okay, so Brian's basically saying this was a great segment.
Yeah,
what am I doing?
You know what?
Here?
It was during a time where we were trying a whole lot of different things, and like I said, we gave it a chance.
It was an experimental
stage. We were young.
We were young.
We just wanted to see what it would feel like.
Exactly.
It's okay, Brian. It happens to everybody. Yeah. We all have our moments. Just certain people more than others.
Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Now, when this little trip down humiliation lane continues, we'll try and wrap our heads around WTF happened with land party guest Amber Smith.
Welcome back to Attack of the WTF, our not-so-greatest moments.
Yeah, everybody's got them, and at least we're honest about it.
True.
You know?
True.
I mean, you got to give us that. We know. Sometimes,
we can't hide it. They saw it.
Sometimes there's an F-up.
Or two. Or enough to make a whole special. Now, normally, our land party guests, they're not exactly booked for their smarts.
Oh, no, they're certainly
right?
not.
But when Amber Smith had both swimsuit model and genius on her resume, and we thought for sure we scored a jackpot.
We've got everything.
How could
we have
gone
wrong? She's smart, she's sexy, she's the whole package.
Clearly. Hmm. Producer extraordinaire Casey Schreiner is here to try and explain what the hell happened.
Casey, yes. What's up with Amber?
Well, Amber Smith has a website, and the word genius appears a lot on that website.
Uh-huh.
But what we fail to understand is that genius often manifests itself in mysterious ways.
Wow. Oh, right.
Shall we see said manifestation?
I would love to.
All right, suffer through it, folks. Here it is.
Okay.
Oh, hey.
Hey, guys. I'm just hanging out with my land party guest here. This is Amber Smith. Just getting to know each other.
Hi.
She's a model, actress.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah. I've got the good job, folks. Today we're playing Joint Operations Escalations. And a big thank you to our friends at Novalogic who are here helping us run the game today. Playing with us today is, like I said, supermodel / super genius, Amber Smith. You don't like super genius?
You gonna bring that up? Only people who are insecure bring that part up.
Well,
I mean,
you're not telling me something I didn't know, ever.
No, I mean you. I just meant, you know, when people bring that up, they try to test me and stuff like that.
Okay.
But we're not gonna do that, right?
No, we wouldn't do that to you. How's the gaming so far?
Well, I've been on about 30 seconds and been killed about 5 times. I think I'm doing excellent.
Okay, well, keep practicing. We are gonna check in with you, Amber, later in the show. Once again, it's land party time. Land party time. Oh, your hair's getting in the way, Amber.
I'm doing my patented flip.
Can you do that again? God, that's worth the price of admission right there. Today, the game is Joint Operations escalation. And we have someone who could kick your ass in Jeopardy and look great doing it. Thrill as I match wits with model actress, super genius, Amber Smith. Amber, your reputation precedes you. So there's a lot of numbers on your website. I want to talk about some of those. You are Loaded's Hottest 100, your Maxim's 50 Sexiest, and you're also GQ's 8 Most Erotic.
Yeah.
What's your favorite of those three?
My favorite hasn't come yet. I would like to get, world's most flexible nostrils.
Really?
Oh, that'd be righteous. Wow. Yeah.
I really don't understand women.
That'd be so
cool. I know that now. But the big number that, you know, you really don't want to talk about, but we, of course, have to present to the people at home is your IQ. It's a genius level IQ, right? What is it?
It is. The only reason why I hesitate is I've been in the modeling business all my life, and it's like there's nowhere to focus your mental abilities. It's like basically
modeling. You don't get to focus your mental
abilities? Shut up. I'm getting so over you, man. You were cute in the beginning, but... Okay. Yeah, see, I am smart, right? Anyway.
But it's like 155.
Yeah.
That's pretty high.
Which is good, and hopefully one day I'll be able to use it. But basically modeling's about persistence. It's about being able to have someone look at your face and say, nah.
Well, since you're so smart, Amber, question one. What does the C stand for in Einstein's theory of relativity?
I learned that like in first or second grade. That's speed of light.
Correct. Also would accepted universal constant. Next question is, what is it like being a genius among models?
Unproductive.
What is the capital of Iceland? You can pass.
You know what? I'll give you this one pass.
What is scientifically smart? Yes, I do. I can take all I can get.
I know it.
Who is scientifically superior? Cats or dogs?
I would have said dogs, but they actually have the same IQ, mm-hmm. which is equivalent to that of a 4-year-old child.
You are full of knowledge, aren't you? Now, you were in LA Confidential, were you not?
Yep.
And supposedly there's a story that Russell Crowe ruined all your close-up scenes. What a jerk.
I adore Russell Crowe. I think he's great. Basically, there was this fight scene that I had to, you know, react to and go, oh.
And what was that again?
Oh.
Good.
See, I'm a really good actress. Right. So anyway, he reenacted this fight scene, and I couldn't get through it. I mean, he was punching himself in the face and the nuts, and he was flipping himself over because the other actor wasn't there.
Oh.
So he was trying
to punch his own self in the nuts.
Yeah, right. Yeah, which he enjoyed doing until 6 o'clock in the morning because I think he probably wanted a date or something. But anyway, he's married. Yeah, anyway, so I never got my close up, but at least I made the movie.
Okay. Now, it took you a couple years to get your own website up, right? AmberSmith.com?
Ooh, rubbing
in. There was a problem with that?
Yeah.
What happened?
I was a victim of cyber squatters.
I'm picturing a guy with his shirt off with Cheeto stains sitting in his basement, right?
Sitting on my name, right.
Yeah.
Basically, yeah. They also, the worst part about it is if they're in the United States, you can go after them, but they weren't. They were in Canada.
And in 1990, I should have figured.
Right. So stop. In 1997, they grabbed my name. 1998, I went and opened my official website. I don't have a name. So basically, I battled them for so long. I spent a lot of money. Finally, I went out and got a lawyer the minute I got this big residual in and just pounded them. And we won through ICANN and still couldn't get the name back.
Well,
finally, we threatened and got it back. And it's been 8 years. I got AmberSmith.com back.
AmberSmith.com.
Where I blog.
Go there.
Yes, please. Because we're putting up a brand new site for this big, you know, hoopla. And I'm going to become a blogger.
I'm on it. Amber,
I'm
I can't
blogger,
wait
to read.
I'm a blogger,
baby.
Oh! Oh, my gosh. Casey. Wow. Casey?
Yes. Well, you know what? Actually, I think that segment has a lot of layers to it. There's a lot going on there.
There certainly is.
There's some symbolism going on. There's some subtext. I think in 5 years, that segment will be awarded an Emmy.
You know, there's one question. Genius, yet no Iceland capital?
Yeah, Reykjavik.
I mean, she was pretty stumped.
Which layer of that segment was supposed to be the entertaining one, though, Casey?
That's one of the ones that's buried.
Oh, so that you have to dig deep.
It's very, very deep. You have to have read some classical literature and, It's very amusing.
Know a lot of Shakespeare.
That's a good exercise. I'm glad we brought Casey out to explain this.
Because, me too.
Now, since your time on the LAN parties, I know you don't do them all that much anymore, but...
I'm very upset,
How does that particular LAN party fit into the grand scheme of the LAN parties you did produce?
That's, that's pretty standard for LAN parties.
Is that standard fare?
Pretty standard, yeah.
Wow.
Well, models. There's so much more going on than meets the eye, you know?
Clearly. Layers.
As she said, unproductive. It's hard being a genius.
It's hard.
And yet stuck in a model's body.
And it's hard watching them explain that on television.
It sure is.
Yeah. Casey, thanks for coming on to defend it. Casey Schreiner, everyone! Let him hear it!
Woo! All right, everybody. You look confused, and you actually should be. This look back at our strangest moments continues with a hefty undertaking we called the Megaphonies.
Megaphonies. Yes, it's Attack of the WTF, where we make the AOTS producers fess up to the segments that went a little haywire.
It feels good to have so much power, doesn't it?
Oh, it's so
Get up
nice.
There and tell us why you suck.
You know what? They made us sit through it, or stand through it, or interview through it, so they deserve
it. And we're the ones
grilling.
Who always look bad.
Of course.
People think that you and I are the people who put together the show.
We show up 5 minutes before the cameras roll, we do our thing.
We have a drink.
During commercials.
Yeah.
And we go home.
And we barely, you know, we slump. During the commercials?
Of course. I take a nap
right after the feed.
Let's just get through this so we can get home.
Okay, good.
All right. Yeah. The Megaphonies. Remember these bad boys?
I remember
them. The Megaphonies were our little goof on the Emmy Awards, and it was a big production.
Big, huge.
Giant. Perhaps a little too big.
Perhaps a little too big.
And sadly, pathetically, the producers involved refused to come out and explain it, even though they still do work here, actually, as far as I know.
Yeah,
they still work here.
Wusses.
Want to come out and explain it. Nobody. Yep,
Look
there they are,
Look
or aren't.
I hope you're happy. I hope it feels good.
Just to relive the horror.
Lay us out to dry.
Here are the Megaphonies.
And each one of them will be walking home with a coveted golden megaphone.
It's right there. All right, stop touching.
Speaking for myself, I know that when I first started in this industry some 16-odd years ago, I always hoped I'd be a big phony. And now I've become a megaphony. So, thank you.
As a Family Guy, it reminds me of that time I was stuck late in the office working on bump outs for the show. Thanks.
Oh.
Tell us, Brendan, who's an early contender for best dress tonight?
I want to see this.
Yeah.
You know, Kevin, I can't make them show up. All right? You know, why don't you just lay off me, and when they show up, I'll talk to them. But until then, just, you know, do whatever you're doing. Unprofessional. Unprofessional.
Okay, well, let's kick things off with those special shows that make us laugh and forget that we're still eating TV dinners off of our lap in front of the TV every godforsaken night.
This is just the first annual.
The first
it's the next
of
Blockbuster
many.
Movie Awards
this,
is what it is
this,
to me.
This is the new BET Awards.
Clearly.
Okay, let's just, yeah.
Thank you.
As you know, Arrested Development has just begun its third season. Oh, wait. No, you don't know, because you aren't watching. You're all too mollified by So You Think You Can Dance, or one of those other reality shows where rejected Access Hollywood hosts build a new outhouse for a meth-addicted clan of inbred mooks. Soak it up. Ignore a show that doesn't tell you when to laugh. Ignore a show that stupidly assumes you can pay attention. Enjoy the According to Jim world you've created, you mouth-breathing yahoos.
It's Sean O'Rourke, a guy who watched all the Lost Season 1 DVDs in a single weekend.
Thanks so much. A buddy of mine lent me these over the weekend, and, well, the DVDs anyway. The show is pretty cool. Thanks.
This way, Sean.
This way. All right. Sean O'Rourke!
John Stewart from something called The Daily Show.
The Daily Show! But since we couldn't clear a clip of the show through the legal channels that we have here, instead is a picture of United Nations Secretary General Kofi Annan.
He looks great for his age.
Kofi?
Yeah. He looks good.
I don't know.
Accepting this award on behalf of The Daily Show from a remote location is Attack of the Show's own Office Jesus.
Oh, hello.
It's good to be here. I wish I could be there, but I've been down here helping with the relief efforts. As you can see, everything's cool here. Waiter, I'm gonna need another one of these, please. Hasta pronto. So, thank you for whatever this is. I don't know. Are we done? Are we done here? Can I get back to the luau? Fantastic.
You know, I mean,
there's nothing really funny about that all of a sudden.
It had all the right flubs that a real award show would.
I was pretty excited. We got dressed up.
We did.
You know? Yeah.
It started off really well.
Yeah.
And then as we were reading the message boards, especially during the show, it was like, oh my God, they're still doing more? Is this the whole show?
All of a sudden, it seemed like kind of a bad idea.
You can't pull the e-brake on something like that when you've got the red carpet.
We were committed, and that is precisely the problem.
It was a valiant effort.
It was a valiant effort.
And the closest any of us will ever come to an Emmy, I'm sure.
I'm pretty sure about that. Yeah. It's kind of depressing, isn't it?
A little bit.
When we turn to this baton death, a march of a show, the guy from Something Awful lives up to his site's name.
Yes, he does.
Welcome back to Attack of the WTF. It's our look back at our show's oddest moments.
Yeah.
Now, we had one of the guys behind SomethingAwful.com on the show, and we had planned the interview to be tongue-in-cheek, but I don't know. Let's just let Scott Michella, producer Scott Michella.
Yeah.
What exactly happened here with Something Awful?
It's a long story. Dr. David Thorpe came on.
Not an actual doctor.
We had a lot of real questions ready for him. He arrived and said, guys, I was going to prank you, but I want to let you know this is what I want to do, and I think it'd be really funny. I said, that would be brilliant. Let's do it. He was going to play this crazy guy and
all right, well, let's look at
let's
it
take
and then,
a look
and
at
then
it.
We'll let you try to defend it.
All right, if it's floating around the net and it's funny, chances are it came from Something Awful. And today I'm joined by one of the main perpetrators, writer David Thorpe. Excuse me, Dr. David Thorpe, correct?
It's a pleasure to be here, Kenneth.
It's Kevin, and it's a pleasure to have you here. I'm a big, big fan of your site, David.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear that.
So for those who are uninitiated, the somethingawful.com, it's been around for a little while. It's a website on the internet.
Yeah, you could say that. I guess you would be right about that.
Yeah.
Internet, yeah.
It is on the World Wide Web, freely available.
Well, if you want to join the forums, you have to pay about $80 a month.
Oh.
But you can browse the site for free, yeah.
All right, so if people are browsing the site, what are they going to find? What is Something Awful all about?
Pop-ups, pop-unders, flash ads,
nice.
porn ads with sound.
Right. Full-screen flash ads?
Oh, yeah. It's going to take a while for you to find any content in the site. Often there is none. So if you like pop-ups, though, it's a huge depository of pop-ups.
Now, the internet used to not be filled with so many pop-ups. Was there a time when Something Awful wasn't completely cluttered with useless crap?
Well, it started in about 1999 as a monster truck rally newsletter, and it was pretty popular. A guy named Lotax did it in his basement and distributed it to his friends, but it got slightly less highbrow since then, so nowadays it's, I don't know, the humor's a little sort of juvenile.
You know?
It's not, you know, people don't like it. You know what I mean?
No, understandable. It's not popular.
No, it's not popular. People don't like it. It's not original.
All right.
We steal most of our content from a guy named Maddox.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The best page in the universe or something like that. Or
yeah.
So he says.
Yeah, most of it is stolen from him.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Now you mentioned the forums. People actually pay to use a message board on the internet?
They pay ridiculous amounts of money for what amounts to nothing.
Wow. Now, why would any goon want to do that?
Well, I guess it's sort of like, I guess you could call it the legitimate front for a cult, and, you know, it's, they promise you eternal salvation.
Join us right there. I mean, it's telling you.
It's pretty transparent that it's just basically a cult.
You'll clearly follow any man that looks like that.
Yes, yeah. That's actually him before the, incarceration.
Yeah. Oh, so he's currently locked up.
He is locked up. He is in jail for selling prescription drugs over the internet, which used to be what the site was about before they sort of... The FBI kind of put the nicks on that whole thing.
They tend to squash the fun, David.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun getting Valium from them. That's why I'm called Dr. David Thorpe, in fact, is because they decided that they needed somebody with the title doctor. Even though I'm not actually a medical doctor, they decided to
nice.
To pretend that I was one.
Good. Now, something else you guys... The interesting thing about the forums, even for the people that pay, is that you guys are... I almost see you, the Something Awful crowd as trendsetters. Like, they influence a good population or a good portion of the internet. All your base really that's kind of credited to Something Awful, even Goatsy, everything, they kind of gear it towards Something Awful. I mean, is that...
Yeah,
is that...
anything that's sort of played out and kind of uncool about the internet, mm-hmm. things that have been around for a long time and everybody hates them by now and the joke is dead, Something Awful is still beating that dead horse, like all your base jokes all the time on Something Awful.
Great.
Yeah, Goatsy jokes all the time. If people don't know what Goatsy is, it's a photo of a man sort of elaborately manipulating himself in a really strange way. So
yeah, that's one way to describe the Goatsy. Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. It's a fun little site, but
so now you're not an actual doctor, but you play one on the internet.
Yeah.
What do you do for Something Awful? You write columns about bands that suck and about bad fashion.
Yeah, basically. My homeboy Zach and I write a thing called Fashion SWAT every couple of weeks where we sort of make fun of old clothes. We get pictures from all over old clothes, clothes that are strange, you know. We had some strange Japanese fashions a while ago. Basically, they're really ridiculous clothes on the surface, and making fun of them is like shooting fish in a barrel. There's nothing particularly interesting or innovative about it, but it's what we do, you know.
It's where you get your kicks.
Yeah, yeah, we get our cheap laughs that way, cheap juvenile laughs.
All right, David, thanks for coming on the show. It's
Thank
great
you
having
much,
you.
Ken.
Folks, for more information on Something Awful, just enter somethingawful.com into your browser's address bar and press enter, and you'll be taken to that magical and disturbing
it's
land.
It's actually somethingisawful.com.
Somethingisawful.com.
Scott.
Yeah. Now, it looks like we got totally pranked.
Right, we got pwned, we as got, the kids.
He derailed, if you will, and you were so worried and embarrassed that you just went along with
it. Oh, clearly. I had no idea what was going on. I got blindsided.
However, not
right,
the case,
Scott?
Right, Scott?
What the viewers don't see is that we rehearsed that segment, a half hour beforehand?
If not less. But
word
the exact
word,
segment.
Except one slight change, it was backyard wrestling, and he changed it to Monster Truck Rally because a guest that went on before him mentioned backyard wrestling, and his gag was shot. So he sat in the corner for a good 5 minutes thinking of another thing to script in there. And it was so scripted, it wasn't even funny, but it didn't come off that way. You're a good actor. Dr. David Thorpe is an amazing actor, and it looks like we got owned big
time. We got owned, according to the internets.
But we didn't.
So. Somebody stole his backyard wrestling joke?
Yeah, can you believe
Another
that?
Another guest is like, I'm using it.
Well, Scott, despite everything, I still think it was an amazing segment, so I'm not going to throw it in the box.
Way to go, Scott. You need a raise.
Yeah, I feel bad that the forum posters didn't quite get the joke. I hope most of our viewers are smart.
You know, we don't expect people on forums to ever understand anything. But,
forum people are not really normal.
No. Thanks for defending it, though, Scott. Appreciate
nice
it.
Nice work, Scott. You tried. Jimmy the Geek, everybody.
That's right, Jimmy the Geek.
One and the same.
Now, since you've all been very, very patient, when we come back, we get to the bottom of the furry question.
What's up with the furry?
We're going to find out. Once we're all. Attack of the show, baby. Attack. Welcome back to Attack of the WTF, our celebration of all of our glorious failures.
And glorious they have been, Kevin. This has been quite a walk down memory lane.
It has. Let's never, ever walk down this road again.
Okay.
Now, though, for the biggest WTF of all, the furries, Sarah.
What's up with the furries?
What are they?
Where
do they
come from?
Why doesn't anyone acknowledge them?
I never noticed them until you actually just brought it up.
I had to point it out. In
fact, they stand in the shadows. They look mean.
I don't know the answer.
I don't either.
To explain, we actually had to go straight to Attack of the Show's executive producer, Jim Downs.
Jim, let's get an answer here.
Please.
Jim?
Fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Take
the head off for 2 seconds and tell us what's up with
First of all, I don't find them scary at all.
No, you don't. It's a fetish at this point. It's a borderline fetish.
It's not a fetish at all. There's
sexual deviancy.
There's nothing sexual about
furry
my interest
parties,
in fur.
And I think there's intercourse.
You have
involved.
Cuddle parties with furries?
No.
So
no,
what's
no.
the deal? Why furries?
No, it was originally to be something strange and absurd, and there was a rule we would pick a segment producer, an NAP, a PA, or an intern to sit at the desk we used to have here and just wear the costume, any costume, the entire time every Friday.
Right.
As
and
sexual
it was,
punishment.
Of course.
It wasn't punishment at all.
Okay, sexual punishment.
They're just there. So they live somewhere in the background, and it was just to be sort of absurd and different, and eventually it became dubbed Furry Friday.
It did, actually, unfortunately. And no one wanted Furry Friday. There was almost a mutiny against
there
you.
There was. At one time, every time I would walk around the office with the fur costume, you know, the head, interns and PAs, people would dive under their desks knowing that I was looking for somebody.
But Jim, you know, it's important to him. Furry Friday had to commence.
I stuck through it. There was a mutiny once. People wanted to stop it. And then I believe it was Scott Michela found like some Yahoo use news group.
Right.
Where there was, you know, alt.binaries.fur.
Dot pervert.
No.
No, but there was a post somewhere.
And anyway, her. And it was there was this whole group of people who watch Attack of the Show because of the fur. Because we understand fur and fur culture. And
Jim, what is it about the fur that fascinates you so?
Yeah, what's your fascination with the fur?
I just think it's just absurd and it's fun and...
And titillating.
Yeah.
So. All right, thank
Thanks,
you.
Thanks, Jim. Well put.
Yes, I think you've emotionally scarred thousands with that. Very nice of you. Mm-hmm. Appreciate the explainer. All right.
On a limb.
To let the healing begin, because it's time, let's bring all the producers back out for a group hug. Oh, come on, guys.
Producers.
Hug it up. There you go. Let the bad segments go.
You guys just taking one for the team.
Wow.
We have the best show ever.
We really do.
We do. Sometimes. I love you all so much.
Every now and then.
I love you.
All right, it's not just about us and what we thought was horrible. It's about what they thought was horrible as well. So we asked you to pick some of your favorite WTF moments. Let's see what they came up with. What do we
have? All right, straight from the forums, El Zorro wants to know, or he says, when Kevin got a good punking in the LAN party. He doesn't want to know anything. He's telling us that was when the girl from Girls Behaving Badly came on, and you were really mad.
Like, here's the deal. Like,
Kevin was really mad.
I was really mad. It's like it's my job to be nice to those guests, and you never know if someone's like a prima donna.
And she was really awful.
I'm like, dude, you're a reality TV star.
And to your credit, there was a point where you were thinking, there's no way this woman is this awful.
No, I walked away, and then they pulled me back for the reveal. So I still hate each and every one of the people responsible for that.
He's so smart. All right. Andy says he thinks the shocking laser tag bit with Brendan and Kevin, that was super funny.
That was not funny at all.
Well, it's a painful kind of a funny.
I don't like being shocked.
I don't either. I won't even play.
That's what was funny.
I don't like getting shocked. I don't like it. And I don't like you with that on without the mask. It's freaking me out, Jim.
It's just a comfortable fur.
Jim in a cow suit.
It's comfortable fur.
And do the robot for me? That's awesome.
Jordan Haas says the Blammies and the laugh track were both very WTF moments, for sure.
They were. The laugh track, people thought we were serious with the laugh track. They were like, they don't have a live audience. Who do they think they're fooling? Morons?
I love it. Blammies. Like,
absolute Blammies. Morons out there.
More like, right? Damn bad website, Kevin.
Exactly.
Tarquinius says, I have to say that the furries are the biggest WTF. Of all.
Yeah, takers.
I'm going to have to agree.
I guess.
for Quinius.
You just well done us while dressed up like a cow.
I know.
All right, that's it. We hope you enjoyed it. We have plenty more crap coming up for you next year, so take care, everyone.
See you around. You've been great. Love you.
Okay.
Computers on Attack of the Show provided by Intel. Game on. Power up. Take control with the Intel Pentium Processor Extreme Edition.